beautiful face to his bulge. Our wide fingers beneath you, cupping and teasing your pink little slit. I kinda want to feel your juices coat my fingers and beard. Kinda want to see just how small your face looks when I push myself between your lips. But you guys basically, you know, you get the gist of what's being said here. If you want, I'm uploading the full chat log to my Patreon. Go ahead and check it out. Links in the description. I got two tiers right now. If you want to view the full chat log and have access to other exclusive early content, check out the link in the description for the Patreon and consider becoming a patron. But I got to hand it to this guy. He was probably the smartest predator I've ever came across. I guess what I'm trying to say is he was really good at, you know, covering up his tracks, kind of, if you will. Didn't give me a name or anything to use to really identify who he was, other than a few pictures. And this guy really threw me off. So in the pictures, he has no ponytail. It looks like he has short hair. I mean, to an extent, it looks like medium length, but it doesn't look like he has a ponytail in any of these pictures. But the guy we confronted at Walmart who ran, had a ponytail. So I find this guy in the store. He looks a lot like this guy that was sending me the pictures, but I wasn't 100% sure. So I went up to him. I asked him, "Hey, is this you?" He says, "No, it's not me." I ask him if he can, you know, identify himself. He refuses to put the accusation to rest. So he's like, "No, I'm not showing you my face. I'm running." He runs. So the whole time we were chasing him, honestly, I thought that it wasn't the right guy just because I was so thrown off by him, this guy having a ponytail and the other guy not. So that's why I didn't chase him all the way to the end, because I was thinking, like, you know, maybe this isn't the right guy. Otherwise, I would have chased him all the way to the end, to the road or whatever the fuck. Like, honestly, I'm so sick of these predators running. Mark my words, the next predator that runs, I will catch him and I will take him down and bring him to justice. The next one's not getting away. Mark my words, all right? But that's all I got for you guys today. Unfortunately, this guy ran. We couldn't get an interview with him. Very unfortunate. If you guys like the content, be sure to subscribe, enable notifications if you haven't already. Like the video, comment on it, share it with your friends, all that good stuff. So with that being said, I'm Skeeter, and I'm out. Peace.
All right, guys, we're at the Walmart out here in Taylor. It's cold as fuck out. This is our potential predator. I don't know his fucking name. I'm gonna have to find that out. He's being like really discreet on the whisper.
Hell yeah.
On the whisper app, he's being really discreet. So.
This guy?
No, this guy on the right. This guy, yeah. We're gonna go in there. Yeah, we're gonna find out who he is. So, I told him I'm meeting the video games. Told him I'm walking over. He should. We should see him in the video games right now. I got the binder back in the suit jacket. I don't want to hear shit.
Right.
I'm freezing my ass off. Hey, what's going on, man?
Yeah.
Hey, with the Predatorial Investigation Unit?
Mm-hmm.
This is your picture, right?
No.
It's not?
No.
Pull the mask down for me.
No, thank you. I've been exposed to COVID.
I don't know about that, sir. Okay, well, we're gonna have to call the cops now, so. All right.
You got the size in the print, boy, 11 over here. We gonna help the cops
out? He just said it. He's running. Keep up, Q. Excuse me, everybody. This man is here to meet a 13-year-old girl for sex. We got a runner. We gotta get the plate. Get his plate. immediately.
Cardio.
Limber up.
Oh, I was like, no, you're the one.
like? No. Look like this? Is that your picture?
Holy shit.
Yeah, that's you, right?
Yeah.
Michael, right?
No, my name's Los.
Los?
Los.
Oh,
Los
this...
Chris Eggers.
Oh, this looks an awful lot like you. That's
it
nice.
Does, yeah, that's yeah. My son.
Oh, you have a son?
Yes, I do. But I have a 15-year-old son.
But you're only 28 years old, so...
No, I'm 34.
You're 34, because on the app you told the 14-year-old girl you were 28,
I'll show you my phone. You can have my phone. I ain't talking
about you were. You have a SpongeBob shirt on. Cool.
Yep.
Okay. See your ID there. You are...
That's me.
And you're born in 83?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so you're lying about your age on the Meet Me app?
No, that ain't me.
Oh, it's not you?
Not my son probably on this.
Oh, but you
no,
just...
No, I understand this. This is crazy. Let's go grab my son.
It's crazy how you happen to be here, and we thought we were talking to you, who was talking to a 14-year-old girl about sex, that you wanted to meet her here for sex.
We did not talk. No,
isn't that a funny coincidence, though?
He's over here.
He's over there? Well, let me talk to you for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is the first message you sent.
I have a 15-year-old
daughter.
Okay. No, yeah, that's
so you said,
my pictures.
So that...
Yes.
On the way for the...
I don't even have this app.
You know, yes. You're in trouble.
Let's just do
actually.
This. I didn't do anything. I
didn't
offer anything.
Okay.
I'm not telling... You know what I mean?
Gotcha. So this wasn't you we were talking to
no,
in the app.
No, you weren't talking to me.
So if I call you right now, your phone isn't going to ring, right?
Mm-mm.
Okay. Can you show me your phone?
Mm-hmm.
Can you turn it on, please?
Mm-hmm.
Can you unlock it?
Yes, I can.
Can you open up the Hangouts app for me?
What Hangouts app?
You must have just deleted it when
Come on, I didn't even touch my phone. I deleted
you?
Hangouts.
I don't know.
Listen.
You seem a little...
I have Scout. Yes, because this is not cool. I don't need this.
Yeah. I don't think anyone needs this. I'll tell you what no one needs a 14-year-old girl to have sex with, is what I'll tell
you. Exactly. I know this.
You
know this because I have a daughter.
Okay. And you do know this because...
I'll
show you what your son was saying. And here she said, you sure it's okay that I'm 14? You say, yeah, as long as you are not the law. So why would you be so concerned that the 14-year-old girl was involved with the law?
I have a daughter. I understand this. Okay.
Well, that doesn't answer the question.
My son is 15 years old. Okay?
So you have a son and a daughter?
And a daughter, yeah.
How old's your daughter?
My daughter is 14. She's turning 15 on August 31st.
How old's your
My
old's
son?
My son
is 15.
Your son is 15?
Yes, he just
okay.
turned 15.
Gotcha. Okay. So we just want to go through this a little more.
Yeah, let's just do this.
Yeah, you say,
I want to see this, actually.
Okay.
Because I actually do want to see this.
You want to know what your son's been up to.
Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. Okay. So you said, I'm going to be your slave to the 14-year-old
girl.
Are
you kidding me?
Yeah.
I'm
going to
be a slave. And
yeah. Apparently you wanted to be a slave. Who's that calling you? Your wife? Oh, perfect. Go ahead and answer it.
Hello? Hey.
Go ahead and tell her what's going on right now.
Because I'm dealing with
Tell her what you're dealing with.
What am I dealing with?
You're here to meet a 14-year-old girl for sex.
Okay, you hear that?
Can you put her on speaker for me,
please?
Yeah. Do you mind? Put her on speaker. Did you hear that, ma'am?
What are you doing, Mike?
Are you Michael's wife?
Yes.
Michael Roberts?
Yes.
Are you aware he is on a dating app called Meet Me, trying to seduce 14?
I was on Meet Me.
Uh-huh, and he's currently on Meet Me trying to seduce 14-year-old girls for sex. Are you aware of this?
No, I'm not. So
okay.
That's where he's at?
That's where he's at right
I'm
now.
I'm at Meyer, babe.
Yeah.
You're disgusting, Mike. I knew it.
Yes, ma'am. He was having a very sexually charged conversation with a 14-year-old girl, and it was agreed upon to meet in this Meyer. And Michael is now here, and the 14-year-old girl is not, luckily we were here instead, because if a 14-year-old girl was here, judging by the chat log, we know what would have gone down, so.
Your daughter's 14.
I understand this. I already told him this. I've already talked.
What's wrong with you? You said you were going
to... You just hang up on your wife like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's just do what we're gonna do.
Okay.
I didn't. This
gotcha.
Is crazy.
Yeah, it
I know how this goes. I
you're
watch
telling
dating
me.
And stuff. No, no, no.
You watch
I do.
What?
I watched the date app and stuff. I don't do this.
Your wife's
this
calling you, Mike. Why don't you go and answer it? Let's.
Listen, she's already got problems
we'll
with me.
Go ahead
I don't
and
want
it.
More problems.
You're gonna have problems when you walk out that door. I need you to answer that phone for us, Mike. Please.
Los. My name is Los. She's just.
Right. But you only just now said that even though I've been calling you Michael for the last 5 minutes.
No, I'm going by this.
Oh, you're... Okay, so you're renaming yourself.
Hello?
Let's speaker, please, Mike.
No. No.
Ma'am, maybe you could confirm.
Listen.
Well, she called you Mike, so.
She did not call me Mike. My name is not Mike. I'm telling you right now, my name is not Mike.
Okay, well, I don't know why.
I'm going by this.
Okay, on the phone, she said your name.
Tony. What is my name?
Sir.
Huh?
I want to talk to a police officer. I want to pick up the car.
This ain't
even
cops.
Ma'am, we are not officials, but we do work in conjunction with the police. Hey, Michael? Michael. If you walk away, we're just going to hand this over to the police, so.
All right, well, listen, this is good. I'm not, this ain't me.
It's not you?
Mm-mm.
Okay, well, we're going to see what the police say about it, then. If you're admitting that it's not you,
I don't want to.
Then you shouldn't have a problem talking to the police.
I will talk to the police.
You won't?
Yes, listen,
well, let's get them over here now, then.
No, let's not.
Why'd you just say that, then?
Because, don't. Listen, you guys.
Michael,
This is bull crap.
Look, is this or is this not your penis?
That is all day. I will show you the picture on my phone.
Okay, show us the picture of your penis on your phone.
But call my phone.
Call your phone?
I didn't even touch this goddamn app.
Okay. Let's see. You gave us a phone number too, so.
You have been on your phone since we've been recording.
So that, whose number is that?
This one.
That's that one?
No, it's that one.
This is your number, right?
No, that's the girl's, my wife's number.
This is your wife's number?
Mm-hmm, she's calling from right now.
Oh. Really? So why did you say text me and then that's your wife's number?
Oh my God, this is not, come on, let's just do this, let's go. I'm not gonna sit here and get questioned all day. Listen, this is stupid, I know it's stupid.
So you realize you could go to prison for this?
No, I understand this.
You understand?
I understand this.
So why is it okay?
Let's go through
what
this.
Makes it okay
go
for you?
It.
Okay. Well, here you said you wanted her to sneak out, and then when she said she couldn't sneak out, you said you could come to her house. And you said you could be like a ninja. And you said, listen, you can get some through the window tonight. Hey, sir, I need you to keep your hands out of your pockets for me, please. Thank you. Just want to go through this with you. Well, do you think maybe you could show me your ninja skills?
Ooh.
Oh, okay. That's good. Impressive. I'm sure the fellow inmates will like it. And,
what was the last message that said? Listen, go to your last messages. Go to
I'm getting to that. I'm going to get to that in a minute.
I told her I did
so
not.
That's also your penis, right?
Oh, yeah. There's three pictures.
And you told a 14-year-old girl that she could sit on it?
She.
Right. Got it. Do you want to try my huge penis?
She never told me she was 14 off the bat. You
she
guys,
didn't?
Listen. You guys should listen.
Should
go
I
back.
Go back?
Let's go back. Let's go back. Come on.
Yeah, we can.
First
can
thing,
go back.
What'd you say?
Okay.
She texted me. Okay?
She did?
Yes, she did. Let's
where?
Go.
Where? This is the very first. Please don't touch
the
binder,
I'm sorry,
please.
I'm sorry.
Please. This is the very first message of the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Hey there, sexy. That's from you.
I send that to hundreds of them.
Okay. But you still send.
She shouldn't be on this app. Do you understand this?
Well.
With her age,
sir?
That is not.
Please.
I'm sorry. I'm just getting mad.
It's okay.
Because, listen, I'm not that type of person. I wouldn't be that type of person.
You're not. From this conversation, you understand it's hard for me to believe.
I understand that, yeah. That's definitely. But can go to the last damn text.
And then what
does
she say? Oh no, I'm really 14.
Yeah,
and when she started.
Yes, I did.
When she started telling you she was young, you said, quit talking about it.
I said,
right
18.
There.
Yes, I
quit
did.
Quit talking about
yep.
it. And your wife's still calling you. You said, you want her to wear. You want her to wear a skirt so you can give her a little testing in Meyer. What kind of testing were you talking about? Were you talking like a pop quiz or some other kind of testing? What were you?
In Meyer,
that's what you said here.
I have no clue.
Okay.
That's not.
Okay. Then you said, because I'm going to make sure I get a few nuts off with you. But the 14-year-old girl.
Really drunk. I'm sorry.
Oh, you were, okay. Got
I'm
it.
Very sorry.
Then you say, because I'm sure that
I
will
be. Didn't I come and say, I don't want nothing? Because you're. Didn't I say the age and stuff? Go in there, please.
I'm still going. Don't worry.
Then
you say, because I'm sure that I will be able to.
I do not want to be recorded.
That I will be. That's not up to you, sir.
Record him, not me.
It goes both ways for our protection, sir. Just to make sure. You can't say I did anything to you, and you can't say I can't say you did anything to me. That kind
of thing. I understand that. That's
okay.
Great. That is great. That is great. You know.
I'm sure. a, in all caps, nug off really quickly with you. You did.
Yeah.
So now you're admitting that you were saying this stuff.
Yes, I did.
Okay. So this whole thing about your son saying this stuff and using your painted pictures was a lie. Sure it's not. And then you said, you might have to act like my daughter because you look so young. So you're worried that people might have some kind of opinion if they were to see you with a 14-year-old girl. So you would just tell them it's you.
I don't want
to. Tell them it's your daughter. Right. And you do have a daughter. A son's daughter. What I want to do is have you try on some clothes in the changing room. And what else were you planning to do in the changing room? I guess we'll be good with that.
such a shame you're a lonely guy.
It's okay, you can see that Paul gets the help that he needs, okay? And Paul, if you love your family and you don't want me to report this, I need you to get down on your knees and I need you to kiss them and let them know how sorry you are.
You feel the way I do.
You need to kiss their feet.
I can't imagine.
You need to go down and
without
kiss
you,
their feet.
My dear.
Let them know how sorry you are.
And I'm so glad about the reason that you
both
came here.
You need both. Yep, both feet. Good. And for this kind woman, tell her how sorry you are.
Because it's really love.
I'm only 14, is that okay? Your uncle here? I have no problem, I like it. Oh, he does know English, because he clearly... Okay, Google Translate. Okay, so what did he say that Google translated to, I'd like to suck your cock and eat your ass? You're not in on this too. How old are you? 29. Okay. Did he do anything to you while you were grown up or touch you? Okay. 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 He seems pretty cool. And he seems pretty eager to meet this, you know, who he sees, a 14-year-old boy.
made it okay.
No, maybe the friends, the work is.
Maybe friends. You wanted to be friends with the 14-year-old?
Yeah, you come in the site for me. So
friends with a couple benefits, I would assume?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it seems like.
Okay.
Yeah, you're pretty eager to meet him, too. I mean, you just hit him up last night. You sent a power message, so. It's illegal to tell someone you think is 14 that you want to suck their cock and eat their ass. That's not acceptable behavior from an adult. How long has he been here in the States? Shouldn't he know this?
4 years.
You know this, right?
Sorry?
You know this is illegal, right?
Yeah, of course it's illegal. 14 years
so,
old.
So, Paul, do you know that this is illegal?
I don't know if he knows
okay.
that he's 14 years old. He's not supposed to go with 14 years old.
No,
he's
not.
18,
they have to be 18, Paul.
18.
Did you know that before, Paul?
I don't know if you read that.
And you knew that.
Yeah.
Then, Paul, why did you continue to have this conversation, this sexually charged conversation with a boy you thought was 14? I mean, what are you thinking? Do you think it's in addition to the internet or in addition to being on your phone? What is it? What causes a man? I don't.
You want me to translate? He's saying
yes.
He was. A friend of him from his work, but I think
who's a friend of who from work? Who's a friend of who?
Of him, another friend from
work. The 14-year-old boy is a friend of his.
No, the friend recommended him to me.
Oh, he recommended to the. His friend recommended him the Surge app.
Yeah, I think.
Okay,
so.
Now who recommended you to say these things to a 14-year-old boy?
Because I don't know anything about this.
Okay, that's fine. I believe you.
I'm like.
Okay.
I'm shaking like this.
Yeah.
And this is new for me, and I don't him to be in trouble. Probably he didn't.
Well,
he didn't
it might be too late for that. He
14 years old. It's a very severe.
Well, he may be in trouble. Let me just tell you that. And you said that's your aunt in the car.
Yeah.
Would that be Paul's
sister? Yeah.
Paul's sister. Yeah. Paul, I think we need to tell your sister what's going on here. Maybe you need some help. Can we tell your sister?
Like, we just came
what's
from
wrong?
Church.
Oh, you just came
from
church.
From church like
two hours ago, well, maybe Paul needs
pictures,
to go.
You know, and you can
yeah.
see me there conducting the choir. And
oh,
singing.
No, you're fine. But maybe Paul needs. Do you take Paul to church? Maybe he
yeah,
needs.
Yeah, he went to church
Paul,
too.
Maybe Paul needs Jesus.
2 hours ago.
Ma'am,
I mean,
do you know what's going on here?
We have live, and I can show
okay.
you. We have live.
Okay.
Live stream, and you can see him in the choir, and me too.
Okay.
I'm like,
well,
I'm shocked. I mean.
Yeah, maybe he needs to be.
Help, you know,
maybe he needs to be taken out of the choir and taken to a hearing with a confession, right? That's what's. Maybe he needs a confession with the priest, because, yeah, I don't know if he's
the pastor.
I don't know if he's been right with the Lord. Ma'am, do you know what's going on here?
No.
So okay. Well, you're.
These guys, I think they're from police.
We're working on a sting operation where we're catching online predators. Grown men who solicit minors for sex on the internet. So what Uncle Paul has done here is, I can show you our proof here. This is the Surge app. The boy says, I'm really 14, is that okay? Uncle Paul says, I have no problem, I like it. And then down here, Uncle Paul says, I'd like to suck your cock and eat your ass. This is what he said, and you can see this is his picture. I mean, it's him, you know. It's him, you know.
He is.
He sent a couple pictures of himself, and this is what he drove over here for, to try to solicit this person he thought was 14, a 14-year-old boy.
I'm sure he was looking. Maybe if he's looking for guys, he's looking for older than him. I don't know.
Well,
he's 14 years
yeah.
old. I told him you. Even
he's looking
girls,
for he's looking
you
for younger than him. I'll tell you that. Man, what do you think of all this, man? I mean, I don't think it's very good behavior. And
no,
of course, because
we
goes to the church every all family. It's a Christian.
Well, I don't know. That might be a front in Uncle Paul's case.
Today he went to the church.
I'm sorry.
He did.
Church today.
Okay.
He
had some trouble.
He's
okay.
Singing,
he had the
he's
girlfriend.
In a car.
Uh-huh.
He's singing a car.
Okay.
But I don't know what's wrong with him.
So
well, do you think maybe he needs therapy or something like that? Maybe you can get him some kind of help?
Yes, I think yes.
He had a girlfriend like two months
ago.
He had
a girlfriend. Okay.
He had a girlfriend.
Yeah.
That's there. We got him. Yeah. Mercury Milan.
It's good.
It's good?
Yeah.
It's holding up pretty good?
Yeah.
Okay. You think it'll hold up as good as your case in court when I forward all this evidence over that you're trying to meet a 14-year-old girl here for sex? What do you think of that?
All right.
Yeah? Well, we got your plate number, so we're just going to call the cops if you leave and send it to them.
Okay.
All right? Cool with that? 911. It's coming right now. Where you going, Daddy? Come on. Where you going? Got his plate number, right? Watch out. Be careful. Well, I mean, police wouldn't get here in time anyway, so what are you going to do? We can still send it to them, though. Some pretty...
He's going to see us, though.
It's fine. I'm having him go in the store. I just want to talk to you a little bit about the sexually charged conversation.
You can see the catch. It's, it's really short. He pretty much runs off immediately, but it's pretty.
Some number. I don't know what it is, but I've been trying to catch this guy for a while. I was talking to him on a previous account. He was talking to a girl that said she was 14. He had a very sexually charged chat with her. Tonight, I'm kind of setting him up in two ways, sort of. So tonight, he's here to meet, and he's technically here to meet an 18-year-old. I switched up the pictures, got a new account. He hit that account up, and this time I told him that the girl was 18. But I'm really about to go in and confront him about the 14-year-old that he was having a sexually charged conversation with. So let's go ahead and in there. You said he's in the shoes section, so I'm gonna go ahead and talk to him. Hey, man, you seen the sex offender 11s anywhere? No. Hey, excuse me, sir. You'd be Scott, right? Scott, right? Scott? What's up, man? Yeah. So, I know you're here to, you're here to meet an 18-year-old and all that. But I just want to talk to you a little bit about the sexually charged conversation you were having with a girl who told you she was 14. Oh, you're a little hard of hearing? Well, do you remember a while back, January or last year in December, you're having a rather sexually charged conversation. The girl told you she was 14. Mm. Yeah, she went by the name Amber. And does ring a bell? That's your picture there, right? Yeah. And that'd be you right there, right? Your Plenty of Fish profile. That'd be a picture of your penis. Right there that you sent?
No.
Oh, no, sir. That is some what you sent, so... sir, we just wanted to... let you know this is not okay behavior. Sir, if I could just have a word with you. He knows he was having a sexy child as soon as I showed him his own dick. Yeah.
it's Liz with Driver's Ed Direct, and today our topic is a really popular one, especially for all of you headed to the DMV for your driver's license test. The DMV, drive test, pre-drive test questions. Oh boy, try saying that 5 times fast. You'll be performing this part of your test before you even leave the DMV parking lot. So acing this part of the test is actually pretty easy, and it's a great way to start your test with supreme confidence. All right, before anything, let's make sure to buckle up. You always want to buckle up as soon as you enter any vehicle. Got it? Good. Now that we're buckled up and we're good to go, it's time for your hand signals. You would use your hand signals to indicate your intentions to other drivers. So if for some reason your signal stopped working or your brake lights, you use the hand signals. Although most likely you'll find yourself using hand signals to interpret the intentions of bicyclists because they use their hand signals to let you know when they're making lane changes, stops, or turns. And there's 3 hand signals. There's stop, left, and right. So let's demonstrate. With your window rolled down, you're going to extend your left hand straight out the window like this. Pointing to the left means you're going to the left. That's pretty easy to remember, right? And now for right turns, your hand's gonna go up like this at a 90 degree angle. Just think of it as you're in class and you know the right answer. What do? You raise your hand. Right answer, right turn. And then for stop, it's going to be the complete opposite of right, where your hand goes down pointing to the ground at a 90 degree angle. That's your indication for stop. Now that we know our hand signals, it's time to turn our attention to the 9 remaining pre-drive controls the DMV examiner will ask you to identify. Number 1, turn signals. Turn signals are located on the left side of the steering wheel. Simply press down for left and up for right. The examiner will inspect your turn signal lights from the outside of the vehicle just to make sure that they are working. Number 2, brake lights. The examiner also needs to verify that your brake lights are working. All you need to do is step on the brake pedal when instructed. Just make sure that the car is in the parking gear if you are asked to take your foot off of the brake. The last thing you want is for your car to start rolling forward unexpectedly, causing you to fail before you even leave the DMV. Number 3, gear shifter. The examiner will ask you to identify the main gears. We recommend taking your test in a car with an automatic transmission where the 4 common gears all cars should have are park, reverse, neutral, and drive. Some cars also have the other selections like brake assist and lower gears, but knowing the 4 standard gears is all you need to know on the DMV drive test. Number 4, hazard lights. Hazard lights, sometimes called emergency lights, can be located in several different places depending on your vehicle. Fortunately, the symbol for hazard lights is a universal double triangle, usually colored red. Just make sure you know where the hazard lights are in the vehicle that you are taking the test in. Number 5, emergency brake. The examiner will ask you to release and reset the emergency brake, which is also sometimes called the parking brake. Again, depending on your vehicle, the emergency brake may be located differently. On the Prius and in many cars, the emergency brake is located near the floor of your vehicle and is operated with your left foot. Other cars will have an emergency brake lever that you pull up to activate, and this is usually located near the center console. Other vehicles may have a push-button parking brake, like this vehicle does. Just make sure you know where yours is and you know how to control it, of course. Number 6, window defroster. Most cars have both a front and rear window defroster control. Learn where these are located in your vehicle. The front defroster symbol is shaped like a windshield, and the rear defroster is shaped like a rectangle. Easy. Number 7, windshield wipers. While many cars nowadays have both front and rear window wipers, the DMV examiner is primarily concerned with your front wipers only. The examiner usually only asks you to point to the windshield wiper control, but you really do need to know how to use them. After all, if it happens to rain on your DMV test and you don't know how to correctly activate your wipers, you just entered the auto fail zone. Make sure you understand how the low, high, and intermittent windshield wiper settings work in your vehicle. Number 8, headlights. Like several other controls we have discussed, your headlight controls will operate differently depending on your vehicle. The headlight controls is usually located on the left of the steering column and has many potential settings: automatic lights, daytime running lights, parking lights, fog lights, high beams, and low beams. Become familiar with your lighting controls and make sure you know how to activate your low beam lights in case it rains, fogs, or becomes dark during the driving test. Number 9, horn. We saved the easiest for last. Know where the horn is located on your steering wheel and be prepared to honk it gently, just like so. And there you have it, the complete set of the DMV pre-drive test questions. So get comfortable with all the controls in your cockpit, and you should be able to pass this part of your test no problem at all. Thanks so much for watching, and until next time, stay safe out there.
Instructor Jay here. Thank you so very much for watching. If you haven't done so already, don't forget to subscribe to our channel where you'll find other videos that will help you pass your test and continue driving safely on the road.
Gears is all you need lights from the test. You'll be performing this part of your test before you even leave the DMV parking lot. So AC.
At Drivers at Direct, we know that learning to drive does not stop after you pass the DMV test. While a good driving.
Hello, current and future drivers of the world. It's Liz here again with Drivers at Direct, and I'm here today to break down lane positioning and spatial awareness in residential neighborhoods. Navigating residential roads can be difficult for new drivers because most of these roads are two-way streets that don't have road markings or lane lines dividing that road into two. So it's important for you to identify your driving lane on the right side of the road and try to stay centered in it as much as possible, as this will be the safest place for you to be, especially when there's other traffic present. When driving in a residential neighborhood without lane lines, just imagine a yellow line running down the center of the road, dividing that road into two lanes. Your job is to stay on the right side of this imaginary line. In many residential neighborhoods, you'll often see sewer manholes near the center of the road. These oftentimes can help you visually divide the road into two. Another thing you can do is just imagine another oncoming car driving towards you. Just think, would we both have enough space to fit in the road? If not, you probably need to move over to the right a little more. Once you have the road divided in half, the next challenge is maintaining a consistent lane position within your side of the road. So to do this, you want to aim high and select a visual target in the center of your lane that's a good distance down the road. We recommend constantly scanning the road about 10 to 15 seconds ahead or about a block or two down the road. By looking further down the road and taking in the big picture, your car should more or less stay centered in your lane automatically. Though you may need to make small corrections, even on a straight road, these adjustments usually are pretty subtle and require very small movements of the steering wheel. If you're having trouble maintaining a straight line, make sure you're not squeezing the wheel too tight or even holding it too loosely. You want to maintain a firm yet gentle grip on the wheel without oversteering. Driving's not like a video game where you're constantly moving the wheel back and forth. Instead, think of it as you're babysitting the steering wheel. You know, you're just keeping it secure and making gentle corrections when needed. Not only is the big picture driving technique key to maintaining your lane position, it also allows you to identify potential hazards earlier. If you aim low and try to guide your car by just staring a few feet in front of you, you'll most likely veer towards your left into oncoming traffic, and you won't have enough time to identify potential hazards until it's it's too late. Anytime you fixate on a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. Now that you've mastered keeping a consistent lane position on the right side of the road, you need to learn how to handle parked cars. When you approach a parked car that's on the right side of the road, imagine that the lane you're in is moving over to the left, and you must move over to the left as well, giving that parked car ample space. Always assume that someone could open the car door at any moment. So for this reason, you want to give at least 3 to 4 feet of distance from a parked car. If no oncoming traffic is coming, it's okay to move slightly into the center of the road to give that parked car enough space. A common mistake new drivers make with parked cars is staring at them because they're so nervous about hitting them. But remember, anytime you stare at a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. So the best way for you to not hit a parked car is to know your lane position and guide your car by looking further down the center of the road. Remember, aim high. Sometimes you'll be faced with both oncoming traffic and parked cars, making your lane of travel more narrow and potentially dangerous. In these situations, slowing down will help you immensely by giving you more control over your positioning and more time to react to potential hazards, like a car door suddenly swinging open. You ideally want to position yourself evenly between oncoming traffic and parked cars, erring on being a little closer to the parked cars, which are less dangerous than oncoming traffic. If the road is so narrow that you're not sure you can safely fit in between the parked car and oncoming traffic, then just yield the right of way to the oncoming vehicle and let them pass before proceeding. So far, we've talked about spatial awareness, with our main focus being on oncoming traffic and parked cars. But let's not forget about vehicles in our own lane in front of us. We always want to keep a safe 3 to 4 second space cushion with the vehicle in front of us. You can determine how far 3 to 4 seconds is by choosing any fixed object on the road that the car in front of you passes, and then counting the time it takes for you to reach that same fixed object. Confused? Well, let's quickly demonstrate how we can determine a 3 second space cushion. Watch the vehicle in front of us. As soon as that vehicle passes that parked car to the right, let's start counting 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000. It took us 3 seconds to pass the same parked car. That's a 3 second space cushion, and that's how far we want to be behind another vehicle when driving conditions are ideal. If the roads are wet or you're driving a heavier truck or SUV that takes longer to brake, then you want to give yourself an extra second of cushion, or 4 seconds total. Residential speeds, a 3 to 4 second space cushion is about 2 to 3 car lengths. And as you move to faster moving streets, you'll see that 3 to 4 seconds is much greater in distance than 2 to 3 car lengths. But that's a topic for another video. Now you know all about how to keep a safe lane position with cars all around your vehicle. Thanks so much for watching, and if you're driving, it's okay to road. Remember, aim high. In front of you, think of it as you're babysitting the steering seconds ahead, so you may need to make small corrections. We recommend constantly scanning the road about 10 to 15 seconds. Would we both have enough? These oftentimes can help you visually divide the road into two spaces to fit in the road. If not, you probably need to move over to the right a little more. Once you have the road divided in half, the next challenge is maintaining a consistent lane position within your side of the road. So to do this, you want to aim high and select a visual target in the center of your lane that's a good distance down the road. We recommend constantly scanning the road about 10 to 15 seconds ahead, or about a block or two down the road. By looking further down the road and taking in the big picture, your car should more or less stay centered in your lane automatically. Though you may need to make small corrections, even on a straight road, these adjustments usually are pretty subtle and require very small movements of the steering wheel. If you're having trouble maintaining a straight line, make sure you're not squeezing the wheel too tight or even holding it too loosely. You want to maintain a firm yet gentle grip on the wheel without oversteering. Driving's not like a video game where you're constantly moving the wheel back and forth. Instead, think of it as you're babysitting the steering wheel. You know, you're just keeping it secure and making gentle corrections when needed. Not only is the big picture driving technique key to maintaining your lane position, it also allows you to identify potential hazards earlier. If you aim low and try to guide your car by just staring a few feet in front of you, you'll most likely veer towards your left into oncoming traffic, and you won't have enough time to identify potential hazards until it's too late. Anytime you fixate on a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. Now that you've mastered keeping a consistent lane position on the right side of the road, you need to learn how to handle parked cars. When you approach a parked car that's on the right side of the road, imagine that the lane you're in is moving over to the left, and you must move over to the left as well, giving that parked car ample space. Always assume that someone could open the car door at any moment. So for this reason, you want to give at least 3 to 4 feet of distance from a parked car. If no oncoming traffic is coming, it's okay to move slightly into the center of the road to give that parked car enough space. A common mistake new drivers make with parked cars is staring at them because they're so nervous about hitting them. But remember, anytime you stare at a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. So the best way for you to not hit a parked car is to know your lane position and guide your car by looking further down the center of the road. Remember, aim high. Sometimes you'll be faced with both oncoming traffic and parked cars, making your lane of travel more narrow and potentially dangerous. In these situations, slowing down will help you immensely by giving you more control over your positioning and more time to react to potential hazards, like a car door suddenly swinging open. You ideally want to position yourself evenly between oncoming traffic and parked cars, erring on being a little closer to the parked cars, which are less dangerous than oncoming traffic. If the road is It's okay to move slightly on the right side of the road, you need to learn how to handle parked cars. When you approach a parked car that's on the right side of the road, imagine that the lane you're in is moving over to the left loosely. You know, you're just keeping it secure and making gentle corrections when needed. Not only is the big picture driving technique key to maintaining your lane position, it also allows you to identify potential hazards earlier. If you aim low and try to guide your car by just staring a few feet in front of you, you'll most likely veer towards your left into oncoming traffic, and you won't have enough time to identify potential hazards until it's too late. Anytime you fixate on a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. Now that you've mastered keeping a consistent lane position on the right side of the road, you need to learn how to handle parked cars. When you approach a parked car that's on the right side of the road, imagine that the lane you're in is moving over to the left, and you must move over to the left as well, giving that parked car ample space. Always assume that someone could open the car door at any moment. So for this reason, you want to give at least 3 to 4 feet of distance from a parked car. If no oncoming traffic is coming, it's okay to move slightly into the center of the road to give that parked car enough space. A common mistake new drivers make with parked cars is staring at them because they're so nervous about hitting them. But remember, anytime you stare at a single object, you tend to gravitate towards it. So the best way for you to not hit a parked car is to know your lane position and guide your car by looking further down the center of the road. Remember, aim high. Sometimes you'll be faced with both oncoming traffic and parked cars, making your lane of travel more narrow and potentially Driving instructor Liz here to go over the skill of acceleration with you. This video is for true beginners, as today we'll be focusing on how to accelerate in residential neighborhoods. Accelerating a vehicle is pretty easy once you get the hang of it, but many new drivers do struggle in the beginning when it comes to smooth acceleration and maintaining a consistent speed. So just like any other skill, you need to do it in order to learn it. So why don't we just get right into it so you can go out there and practice it for yourself. When talking about acceleration, we're dealing with the gas pedal, or should I say the accelerator, as more and more cars these days are not being fully powered by gas. The accelerator is right down there by your right foot. When we use the accelerator, our number one goal is smoothness. Whatever we do, we never want to slam on the gas pedal or floor it. Otherwise, we'll find ourselves going from 0 miles per hour to 60 miles per hour. So instead, what we want to do is we want to keep a nice gradual increase in speed as we begin to move the vehicle. The best way to accomplish this is by keeping the heel planted on the floor and then pressing the gas pedal gently with the ball of your foot. Apply gradual pressure until you feel the car moving at a nice, comfortable pace based on the speed limit for your situation. Once you get the car up to the speed limit, you want to slightly ease off of the accelerator a little bit. The car should sustain the appropriate speed for you unless you're on a hill or incline. However, if the car begins to slow down too much, just apply gentle pressure to the accelerator to slightly increase and maintain your speed. On the other hand, if the car is going too fast, just ease off of the accelerator a bit. This should slow down the car gradually. You may need to use a little brake if you are still speeding up a little too much after taking your foot off of the gas. For reassurance, distance, you can take quick glances at your speedometer to make sure that you're going at an appropriate speed and to adjust your speed accordingly. And in time, you will develop a feeling for the speed that you're going, and you won't have to rely on the speedometer as much as you did in the beginning. That's the basics of accelerating. Not too bad, right? After some practice, most new drivers realize that they don't need to work on the accelerator as much as they thought they did. You know, you're not constantly stepping up and down on the pedal like you would in a video game. It's more a matter of gradual maintenance on the gas pedal and making slight adjustments as needed. Here's a few more important tips to keep in mind when accelerating. Whenever accelerating from a dead stop, like when you leave the curb, always remember to do your smog traffic checks first. Signal, mirrors, over the shoulder, go. Always be ready to ease up on the accelerator and be prepared to use your brake pedal. For example, you'll want to take your foot off of the gas immediately and cover your brake if you see a potential obstacle, like a child running, a parked car opening its door, or any other road hazard. Accelerating too quickly when the roads are icy or wet could cause you to lose traction and you may skid. Not only are gradual adjustments in speed safer, they will also ensure better gas mileage and will help minimize wear and tear on your vehicle. While you don't want to accelerate too quickly, there are some situations in which you will need to accelerate a little more aggressively, like when you're entering a busy road from a side street or when you're getting on the freeway. But that's a topic for a more advanced video. But that's it for now. From Liz and everyone here at Drivers at Direct, thanks for watching and happy accelerating.
Instructor Jay here. Thank you so very much for watching. If you haven't done so already, don't forget to subscribe to our channel where you'll find other videos that will help.
Hi, I'm Alejandra with Drivers at Direct, and today we're going to learn all about braking and stopping. So now we're going to discuss the pedals. We have the gas and the brake pedal. Now, the accelerator is on the far right side, and the brake is on the left side. Now, we only drive using our right foot. If we use both feet and accidentally step on both pedals at the same time, you can cause serious damage to your car and actually get into an accident. The emergency brake is found on the far left side of you. There's also a center lever, or there's also a push button. When slowing down, you want to use your mirrors just so that way you are aware of what's behind you. If we slow down unexpectedly, the person behind us won't have enough time to react, which can cause a rear-end collision. Smooth stops are always safer because it's a less of a chance of you to get rear-ended. It's better for the wear and tear on your brakes and tires, and also more comfortable for your passengers. Examiners also love feeling smooth stops since they feel like you have a better control of your vehicle. So now that I've explained to you the importance of braking smoothly, I'm going to show you how to attempt a smooth stop. The first step to slowing down is you want to ease your foot off the gas pedal and then cover the brake pedal. That way your car naturally starts to slow down by itself. Then you gradually put pressure on the brake. And you'll notice I kept my heel planted and pivoted versus completely lifting my foot when moving between pedals. A common mistake seen with a lot of new drivers is they start slowing down a little too late, which the result is at the end there's a rough or abrupt stop. Now, a suggestion, the earlier you start slowing down, the smoother stops you get. When you see a red light up ahead, you know, why wait last minute? Ease your foot off the gas pedal and let the car naturally slow down so that way you end with a smooth stop. So when we're at a red light or a stop sign, you want to stop a couple feet before the limit line. So basically, you stop right when the crosswalk or limit line disappears from view. Stopping on the limit line or over it can cause points on it gets to a point where we are completely blocking the intersection, then that can impede people's right-of-way, which can cause an automatic fit. When stopping behind another vehicle, we want to make sure we don't stop too close. A very good trick that we teach a lot of our students is when we're slowing down, about to make a stop, we want to make sure we're able to see their back tires touching the pavement. That's how you know we have a good amount of space. When stopping at a stop sign, it is very important to make full and complete stops. That way, it gives you enough time to perform your traffic checks. Rolling through stop signs can cause automatic fails. In a residential area, don't stop at an intersection that doesn't have a stop sign, unless there's a pedestrian crossing or there's a hazard ahead. At intersections, at a green light, we want to make sure we avoid unnecessary stops because, first of all, it's our right-of-way, and second, people behind us don't expect us to stop, which can cause an accident as well. Alright, let's do a quick recap of what we learned today. Remember, only use your right foot when braking, never your left foot. Never slam on the brakes unless it's an emergency. Instead, use a gentle, gradual pressure just so that way the car can slow down in time. To avoid being rear-ended, make sure to check your rearview mirrors before you start slowing down or stopping, just so that way you are aware of traffic behind you. Always strive for the smoothest stops. Try to avoid abrupt stops or jolty stops. Remember to stop a safe distance before crosswalks and limit lines. When stopping behind other vehicles, we want to make sure we can at least see their back tires touching the pavement. Don't roll through stop signs. We want to make sure we make full and complete stops before the limit line. And finally, when in traffic, try to avoid stopping unnecessarily when you have the right of way. Hopefully it goes well on the drive test, and I'll see you in the next video.
Good.
How's it
hand up, and I'm going to say, at the intersection, turn left.
Okay, I
got it. So whenever you see my hand go up, you know something's coming.
Okay.
Up there.
Okay.
Okay? I don't go turn.
Okay.
Like maybe your friends or family does.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
So you'll let me know beforehand.
Way beforehand.
Okay, got it.
Okay? Any questions for me about anything?
Okay. I have, I think, two.
Good.
If I need my sunglasses, will I be able to put them on? Okay.
Anytime you need.
Okay. When I'm driving, is this not appropriate? Like this holding the wheel? Should I be always?
Whatever you want.
You can't tell me? Like, is that?
No, really, you can do whatever you want.
Oh, really? Okay. But you won't dock me points for this? Like, holding
no. There are a couple really, really good ways.
Uh-huh.
I'll watch how you drive.
Okay. I'm just saying because I'm comfortable like this, and like I try and go like this, but it doesn't seem comfortable to me. But I didn't know if that was like you have to do it like this.
Not at all.
Okay. All right.
If I take one person out with one arm, what do I do? You can't really hold it any other way than pretty much one way.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Well, I think that's it.
Okay.
So, seatbelts.
Time.
Okay. Just need to make sure. I think we're good. You got your seatbelt on. I got my seatbelt on.
All the way to the end of the street.
Uh-huh.
Thank you for stopping there, person. We appreciate that.
Yeah.
Up ahead, Shaw, turn right.
Got it.
The speed limit here is 50 miles an hour, 50.
Okay.
Stay only in the right lane. At the end of this fence here, turn right.
Okay. off. Yeah, when I take off.
Oh, that'd be so exciting if someone would do that. I don't ever
yeah.
have that.
That was my problem when I first started driving. My dad was like, whoa,
really?
Calm down. I was like, sorry. Yeah, it's not speeding. It's just like the takeoff I would kind of get.
Oh.
I heard that also cars are all different, like the pedal.
Every one of them.
Yeah, so I think mine, when I first got it, I wasn't used to it. So.
Mm-hmm. Because you could have gone to another one, and all of a sudden that
yeah.